The key idea behind how we use panel data to get at causality was the common trends assumption. If there's some unobserved confounder, it can differ in levels across the treatment group and the control group, but the changes over time have to affect each group the same on average. Now, there's one very important special case of this, and that's called a fixed effect or an individual effect. This is a variable that doesn't change over time. So the idea here is that we can let the value of this unobserved variable be different in the treatment group and in the control group, okay? But as long as the changes aren't systematic, which they aren't because by assumption, this variable isn't changing over time, so the changes are always zero, that's fine. That's totally fine. It doesn't violate the common trends assumption. So we can allow for these unobserved fixed effects, variables that don't change over time, but are systematically different across the treatment and control group. So for example, let's look at the death penalty example. Suppose that gun ownership wasn't changing over time. There were just some states that had high gun ownership all the time and some states that had low gun ownership for every year. And nothing's changing, it's just the same. So in this case, suppose that all the states that had the death penalty in 1977 were the ones that had high gun ownership. And all the states that didn't have the death penalty in 1977 were the ones that had low gun ownership. That's totally fine because the common trends assumption is still satisfied. The changes in gun ownership, which is zero, they're not going up, not going down, are the same across groups because they're not changing across groups. So having these unobserved fixed effects is totally fine for panel data. That's the key strength of why panel data is powerful for getting at causality. We don't have to observe these unobserved fixed effects. I don't have to have in my data set a number that tells me exactly how many guns there are per state. So as another example, let's think about the effect of being in a union on your wage. Well, we usually think that people who are in unions might have higher skills overall than people who aren't in unions. So you can't just compare the average wage of union members with the average wage of non-union members because there's this confounding variable, skill. Skill might be systematically different between union members and non-union members. So what are you going to do? Well, if skills don't change over time or they change in some way that affects union members and non-union members equally, then we can use panel data to learn about the effect of union membership on wages. Now, another thing to take away from this example that differs from the death penalty example is that for the effect of union membership, the treatment status of different unions, of different units, doesn't all change at the same time. So for the death penalty example, we went from 1975, where the death penalty was illegal everywhere, to 1977, where the death penalty was legal in some states. So at one time period, a bunch of states changed their treatment status, and a bunch of other states didn't. Now, with unions, some people are going to be joining and leaving the union at every different time period. So there's no way to cleanly split up your data into everyone's in a union in one time period and nobody's in a union in the other time period or something like that. It's fine. I can still apply this difference in differences style idea to learn about causal effects. Thank you.